Okay, team, I think we're gonna take it down the stretch here. Not bad.
I got the number four ones.
Okay, here we go. So we're gonna revisit this piece tomorrow. We actually do a skill drill. I have a little bit of, not gonna give you a lot of homework. However, for tomorrow, we're gonna actually do a skill drill. How many of you feel like you could invest between now and 9 o'clock tomorrow, you like that? Between now and 9 o'clock tomorrow, invest 10 minutes to actually maybe take a look at a real prospective customer, check out their website, just figure out who they are, what's going on, and just get a little bit of stuff in your head around what they're doing. Right? That's all I'm asking you to do, right? You could do that at breakfast over coffee, you know, you could do that over a cold beer, whatever you want to do. I'd like you to leave here where you had the opportunity tomorrow to actually work on a real business opportunity. And it would, you know, that would be, we could actually say that you use some of that time to invest in a prospective client. So I'd just like to throw that out to you. Okay, so it's not a lot of work, it's just, hey, you know, here's somebody that I'd really like to connect with. You just check out their website. Maybe Google them, go on LinkedIn, see if we're connected in any way. Just check it out. See what I know about their business, their industry. Just do a little bit of research on them. That's all I'd like you to do. All right? As a little homework. Now, let's go to page 21. New customer acquisition. We talked about the pipeline. Little pipeline piece. Keeping the active target part of the pipeline healthy. Setting goals within the pipeline, and we just built and practiced the creation of a connectivity script. In that segment, team, one or two things that resonated with you on the job commitment, something that you feel like you would be committed to doing differently when you get back on the job. I'd like you to write something down off of that little piece that we did. And a story is building. Now, Ken actually brought up something with me that I thought was really good insight off of the connectivity script that Pearson did. And if somebody does say to me, hey, where'd you find that information out? I'm very transparent with where I found that information out. And if I did find it out on their website, I will say, well, I did some research and there were some specific things in your website that really grabbed my attention. And those are the things that I really looked at. People are proud about some of the messages that they put out, and a lot of people don't pay attention to what's going on the website. So, you know, you can actually say where you found that information. You know, it could be, you know, I did a little bit of some Google research. I Googled this and I found an article about your business. I found this press release and it really resonated with me. So that's absolutely okay to let people know where you found the information. Because they may say that to you, Pearson. They may say, where'd you get that, right? And just be very transparent. Now, also with key influencers as a little bit of a tip, whatever they share with you, you gotta make sure that, you gotta ask them the question, is this information confidential? Is it okay that I mentioned that I had this conversation with you about that? So we gotta protect our key influencer, because they might say, yeah, you might not wanna talk about that. That's kinda here, right? So make sure that you verify with your key influencer, is that okay if I mention that that's going on in their business? Just a couple of key things, and anytime I have an idea that I share with you, it's probably because I got my wrist slapped or did something that got me into a little bit of trouble, right? So sometimes our greatest learning experiences are when we fall off the bike and scrape our knee, right? So just think about those pieces. Anybody write something down that really resonated with you from that piece around new customer acquisition, pipeline or connectivity script?
I like to say the opposite of what you normally say. That's huge.
The opposite, yeah. Yeah. And it's going to feel a little bit different, and it's going to feel a little bit uncomfortable to do it. But anytime we make a change or do something different, it does feel that way. And that's okay, right? That's okay. Anybody else just around that piece? Ken?
I like the invest, learn, and share.
Cool. Those are energy words. And they sound different. Ken, and that's what I'd like you to do, is just do the opposite and be different. So if you think about it, are you making an investment in their business by meeting with them? You're investing part of your 1,880 revenue generating hours. So you are investing in them to learn about their business. Do you want to learn about their business? Yes, I want to seek to understand first. And you want to share some information about what you're doing to help companies like theirs. That's it. Invest, learn, and share. Those are great energy words. Okay. Now, we're on our last module. It's a fun one, because we're going to do a big team competition quiz, stuff like that. Like that? Like quizzes? You like competitions? All right. First of all, we're going to talk a little bit about the changing role of a sales professional. And when I kicked this off at the beginning, I mentioned to you that I started my sales career in 1986, and team, I'm a different salesperson today than I was in 1986. And how many of you are familiar with the Canadian Professional Sales Association? I know that Roz introduced that at the beginning, and so there is actually a designation for sales. Did you know that? So I am a CSP. I have my CSP designation, which means I'm certified as a sales professional. Now I know that that may scare some people out there, but that certification means a lot to me. So I invested in that certification to send a message to the marketplace that I take the sales profession very seriously, that I invest in myself to be the best that I can be for my clients, for my customers, and I'm continually seeking to get better. And within that CSP, I have a responsibility. There's a code of ethics I need to live up to. There's a set of skills that I need to behave. There are some fundamental things that I need to do as a professional salesperson. I want to send that message to the market. What I love about my CSP is that I got it probably about 17 years ago. But I remember when I got it. And my father is a professional engineer. So he's always had on his business card the letters. P-E-N-G. David, he's got them. Check out my brother-in-law. He's an MBA and he's a CA. He's got like five letters beside his name. I had nothing. So I get my CSP and I take the engineer and the accountant out for dinner. And we're having dinner and I take out my new business card and I put it down on the table. CSP. Fantastic. Engineer looks at it and goes, CSP, what's that? Certified sales professional. Right up there with your professional engineering degree. Right there with that MBA, that CA. I belong in the club. Team, you got to be proud to be a professional salesperson. You really do, right? So my job here today is not to talk to you about, you know, what we got going on at the CPSA. However, beyond here, I'm hoping that you'll consider thinking about these kinds of sessions. And I know that, I think I heard, Roz, that you have credits towards this, right? And that says to the market that you are investing in yourself to become a better professional for your customers. And I think that's okay to advertise that, right? I think that's okay with some of your relationships to say, you know, I was just at a conference with colleagues and here's some of the things that we were working on. And part of my role and responsibility as a professional salesperson is to get better for my clients. I think that's okay to say that. I really do. Okay? Now, we're going to do an exercise at your tables. I call it the then and the now. What has changed in the world of selling? It has dramatically changed. If you step back and say then and now, what are some of the significant changes? What I'd like you to do is at your tables, I'd like you to go to that page. Page 9, and I'd like you to talk about what's changed in sales. And you could even look back that there's been significant changes in the last 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20 years. Significant evolution of change in the world of sales. So at your tables, a little conversation, the then and the now, the changing role of a sales professional. Let's see what you come up with. Okay, I'm going to bring you back. Let's get a sense of the then and the now. Lots of things have changed. Sales has really evolved. Let's talk a little bit about that. What's something that's really kind of changed in the world of professional selling? Yes?
The internet, because there's too much access to information.
So
customer knows too much sometimes.
Really good. So the internet has changed the game, right? And I think if you think about it from the customer's perspective, is it fair to say that customers are more knowledgeable and more savvy than ever before?
Yeah.
Now just think about this change in the real estate industry. You know, today, you call up a real estate agent and you say this, get me in this house. Because you've already gone on the site, you've already checked out the house, you've looked at the one you've wanted, and you say, get me in that house, I want to take a look at it. You've actually almost gone through the buying process, right? Where the then was that real estate agent would do what? They would drive you around the neighborhood. They'd pick you up, they'd drive you around, you'd look at properties together, you'd go, I like that one, let me set up an appointment for you. Now you call them and say, get me in the house. How's that for change? Right? That is change. Take a look at the car industry. Today, you can go to autotrader.com on your phone. You can see a car that you like. You can get it narrowed right down. You can text the dealership and you can say, I want to come in and have a test drive on that vehicle. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing. That quick, you can do that. There's change in technology. What else has changed? Yes, Karen.
Time. It used to be that a rush was like 5 to 10 days, but now it's overnight.
How's that?
Use the courier app or
time has changed. The impact of immediate response. Somebody texts you, they expect a response. Somebody emails you, they expect the immediate response has been a significant change.
Tomorrow, not just a response from you. Whereas when I started, like, to get a supplier to do something in 5 days, that was a rush. Sometimes 2 weeks was a rush, right?
Wow.
2 weeks we charge for.
Yeah. What's another one? You have one?
Consumer expectations.
Consumer expectations, and that's why I wanted to talk. I talked about service earlier. You used to wow people with service. Today, it's table stakes. Right? It used to be a core differentiator. People just expect it now. Right? They're not as wowed anymore when you do something on time. It's just expected. Right? David?
Yeah, I was also going to say trust, because nowadays there's so many ways of fact-checking about a product, whereas the old days, salesmen wouldn't probably tell you anything to get the order.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. Again, back to the internet. People have so much information available to them at their fingertips. If you think about things like Twitter and social media, I mean, organizations have departments today just to take that on when a customer makes a complaint, right? So the change on the internet is just significant, right? Anything else outside of internet? Yes, Logan.
The economy.
The economy. What about the economy?
Well, I can't speak from experience back in the 90s, but I know those that the economy was much stronger. A lot more opportunity, a lot less competitive, and I guess now the smaller budgets, higher competitive nature, more feet in the field.
The world has gone glocal. How do you like that for a term, glocal? We live in a world now that's global, but it's actually local, if you think about it. That's what's really changed. If you think about competitive threat, how many people have got into your industry that shouldn't belong there? You like that one, eh, David? Good.
Is that all the ones that are in the seminar?
If you think about who would have thought that grocery stores would have got into the financial space? All right? So that's what's happened. There's this complexity of competition, and the world is sensitive to price, and it's very competitive. That's really changed and put a lot of pressure on the professional salesperson to be able to somehow differentiate themselves, right? Which makes it a significant challenge, right? Anything else that's changed?
I think it's just tough to come to suppliers for large orders. Now sometimes they can just go right directly overseas and
yeah, there you go. So is it fair to say that some of your clients are empowered now to do some things maybe differently than they did with you before, right? Significant change, yeah. So team, we're facing these all the time. And the question is, how do we reinvent ourselves? Now, there are some things, however, that we did in the past, the then, that are actually kind of maybe new and exciting again. Can anybody give me an example of some small things that we can do that could differentiate ourselves against everybody else that were in the then, but could really catch somebody off guard in the now? So picking up the phone and actually reaching out to somebody. A little louder.
Handwritten letter.
Now, I'd like you to think about this for a moment, because there was a kind of a cool article I read around this. When's the last time you went to your mailbox, opened it up, and you got a letter, and it was printed, and it had a stamp on it, and you looked at it, and you stood at it, and you went, what is that? But you opened it, and it was exciting because there was something in there that was handwritten. There's been some studies on this where those little touch points that were in the then are now becoming these soft differentiators. So, you know, I had somebody come up to me, I think it was Alex who came up to me and said, you know, how do I, you know, I maybe have some accounts where I can't provide reward and recognition if they provide me referrals. But what if a handwritten note showed up in the mail and it said, simply, thank you so much for thinking about our business. Thank you so much for referring me to this person. So there's some psychology that some of these things that went by the wayside actually now have become a differentiator because they're different. The old has become different again. So just think about some of those creative things that you can do that might seem the then, but today they could be very refreshing, right? Kind of cool, right? Because we've stepped away from a lot of those touch points, right? We've stepped away from a lot of those touch points. Anything else just around this whole concept of the then and now? Yes?
More face-to-face.
More face-to-face. So is there more face-to-face or less face-to-face?
Less.
Yes.
That to me is the differentiator, making the time to have more face-to-face.
Yeah.
As opposed to constantly either this or, you
know. Yeah. But we tend to use tools like Skype, and we're using WebEx, and we're using, you know, all those types of technologies to get face-to-face. It's harder to get face-to-face, right? David?
One thing is Christmas gifts. Years ago, we used to send Christmas gifts to our top whatever number of clients. Now, we've just started again. We send it to a handful of clients because they're just not used to it now.
Yeah, and one of the changes, though, it's interesting you bring this one up, and it's not expensive, but one of the changes in a lot of industries is that they're not allowed to accept. That's been a huge change. So there's a lot of industries now that have policies in place where they don't want the buying decision being influenced by external factors. So they've put these policies in place where you can't influence. Give you an industry, changed overnight was the pharmaceutical industry. Changed overnight. If you looked at a former pharmaceutical sales rep, you used to walk in there with some Tim Hortons donuts, some coffees, some goodies, and you'd go in there, and all you'd want to do is see if you could get past the reception to get that doc's time for 5 minutes. Can't do it anymore. Can't do it anymore, right? So those things have changed. So the question becomes, how do we compete in this type of changing marketplace? Well, I think there are some core ingredients that remain the same. And I think what remains the same is what we do before, what we do during, and what we do after the interaction with our customers. And we're going to take a look at that, and we're going to have a little fun little exercise around a team competition. I got to move some of you around for this competition. You like that? But we're going to give you a little bit of a warm-up on here, okay? So I'm going to get you to go to a page with me in the guide, and I'm just going to do a little reading with you for a moment. And this is really just around the before, the during, and the after. Creating a differentiated customer experience. Organizations today are continually looking for ways to differentiate themselves in a very competitive marketplace. It is very competitive. And that point of differentiation is getting harder and harder to do. There's not many companies in the market today that can purely differentiate themselves on product alone. There are a few. How many of you have read the book? It's kind of a cool read if you want to read a neat book. It's called Blue Ocean Strategy. Okay, now, Roz, it's a neat book because if you read that book when it was published, which was a number of years ago, and you read it today, the actual companies that are in that book when they wrote it no longer have their core Blue Ocean Strategy. So I'll give you an example. Cirque Soleil took out Barnaby Brothers Circus. Cirque Soleil became the future of a circus. And they literally took out Barnaby Brothers, which was the traditional tigers and elephants and all that kind of stuff. Cirque Soleil came in and just ate their lunch, and they created this unique point of differentiation, just in the way that they created this circus experience. Give you another one. If you look at wines, how many of you love wines? You know, it used to be that we get caught up in the Rothschilds and the French wines and the expensive wines, right? And everybody's trying to be a wine connoisseur. All of a sudden, there was a couple of wine companies in Australia that differentiated themselves in the marketplace, created a unique point of differentiation, blue water strategy, to separate themselves from the competition, and it had nothing to do with the wine, it had everything to do with the
label.
Had everything to do with the label. Why? How many of you have walked into the wine store, the liquor store, and you went, let me look for the cool label. I'm going to go to this party tonight, but I'm taking the wine with the coolest looking label. Right? Look at that. I got the crazy duck. You know, I've got this one. I got that one. And they literally, the Blue Ocean strategy, which is a strategy that separates yourself from the competition, Blue Ocean meaning be in the blue water, not the red blood water with the sharks, get ahead of your competition, but do something that uniquely differentiate yourselves. But the interesting thing is, if you read that book today, some of the companies that they talk about no longer have that Blue Ocean strategy. And what that says is it's very difficult today to differentiate yourself on product alone. You gotta do it through the behavior of the client experience. So let's just talk a little bit about that. Customers demand more from the buying experience. The buying decision is no longer being made on price. It is also being made on the value they receive from the knowledge, advice, and guidance of the salesperson. So we're saying that price sensitivity is very high, but we're also saying that customers today are also making that buying decision based on the value of the knowledge and experience of that salesperson. They will put weight on that, which means that all of us in the room, including me, need to be very savvy when it comes to our industry experience, what we know about our customers, our product knowledge, their internal strategy. We need to be very knowledgeable about this stuff, right? It's not just about going in there and selling them product. Sales professionals need to continually invest in their skills to become the best that they can be for their customers, themselves, and their organization. Now, high-performing sales professionals recognize that change requires them to stay up to date with product knowledge. At the same time, they encourage their customers to see themselves as advisors to their business. Now, a differentiated customer buying experience is built on the following foundation: what we do as sales professionals before, what we do during, and what we do after the customer interaction. So here's what we're going to do, okay? We're gonna have a little bit of fun, especially around the piece of the during, okay? Right now, at your tables, I'd like you to just work at your tables, and I'd say, I want you to ask this question: what are the fundamental things that you do to get ready for a meeting with a prospective customer or customer? What are the fundamental things that you do today to get ready for that meeting? So let's imagine for a moment that you've reached out to me, you've booked the appointment, I've said, yeah, I want to meet with you. To get ready for me in that meeting, what's the fundamental checklist you do to get ready for that meeting? You ready to go? Just the before, just the before. That's all I want you to work on. Okay, see what you come up with. What are those fundamental activities? And it can't be planning in their lobby. Okay, let me just get a sense of before. Anybody want to share with me what you do before you would go out and visit with a prospective customer or an existing customer? Just give me one.
Prep questions asked.
Okay, now Karen, thank you for that start, because I was curious to see if that one would come out. How many of you have prep questions to ask? Okay, very good. Now, I would say today that one would probably be the most important one to have in a first discovery with a prospective customer. What am I going to ask this prospective customer today. Now, is it fair today that this question is no longer accepted? You ready? Somebody may hit the security button. Watch this. Tell me a little bit about your business. It is over. It is done. That question is in the then. It's in the before. It's gone. You got to know. So the types of questions we need to ask today are what we call thoughtful questions, questions that leap off of our research. So let me give you an example. If I said, tell me a little bit about your business, that would suggest what? I don't know very much about your business. But if I said, Roz, I understand that a key priority for your business this year is to actually improve your customer satisfaction scores. Can you tell me a little bit about that strategy? What does that suggest? I know something about your business that's compelling, and I'm driving a question into it. I need more information, but it's something that's very relevant to what I can help you with. So questions today are not just about making them up in the moment. It's thinking strategically about what are 2, 3, 4 discovery questions I need to ask this client to cause them to think, compare, and predict. That is a great start. Questions, we need to think about them, right? Now, I also believe that your first question, your first open-ended question is probably the most important question to plan for. It can't be too tough, but it can't be too soft, but it's got to drive us in a collaborative place. And we're going to talk a lot about this tomorrow. We're going to really work on what I call a strategic questioning strategy that really helps us be more compelling. Because we want to leave somebody's office and we want them to say this about us. Wow, those are really good questions that I was asked today. Boy, that person really knew their stuff. And if I do that better than anybody else, that could be a unique point of differentiation through my behavior. Okay, questions. What else do we need to prepare for? Steve.
I like to anticipate objections and come up with solutions.
How good is that? I want to anticipate objections. I want to kind of think about, based on this meeting I'm going to, what might be some concerns, resistance, or objections I may face. I don't want to do this at the end of the meeting. By the way, you never brought up this. I was really ready for that one today. Do you want to just throw it at me now, or are we good? What I am thinking about, though, is what if this comes up? How can I deal with that? Again, that would be a best-in-class practice for a high-performing salesperson on the before. What else on the before?
So as they're distributors. And as a supplier, if you want to research what the distributors optimal set specialize in, most distributors specialize in different areas, so you want to know what industries or areas that they specialize in.
Very good. So you want to have an understanding of where is their unique point of specialization, their area of focus, what are they working on, and maybe some insight on what those industries are. Is that fair?
Yeah.
You don't need to be a subject matter expert, but is it fair to say that you're in tune to what are going on in some of those markets?
Yeah.
That can be a differentiator. Team, in my development plan in 2015, one of the areas that I wanted to improve at was I felt that I needed to spend more time getting to know some of the industries I was working in. So that's just doing some research and understanding those industries. We don't need to become a subject matter expert, but boy, can that be powerful information when we go into somebody's office. Anything else on the before? Logan.
Prepare a keepsake.
Give me an example of that.
Well, depending on what industry they're in, it's an item that you leave behind to keep it top of mind. It also shows that you're preparing a product that's useful for them.
Nice. So a little gift to keep you top of mind. How's that? Yeah, that's very nice. Anything else on the before?
So on the flip side, for suppliers, when you research the industries that they're in, when you go to visit, you want to be able to bring samples or have samples that are related to the industries that you've done projects with for other people before that you could offer suggestions or strategies to solutions for.
So that is the concept of story selling. social evidence. Now, we've got to be careful. Those are in our back pocket.
Yeah, you don't bring them out right away.
But you got them when you need them. How good is that? Very nice. Yes?
We tend to avoid bringing in product for the very first meeting, and that kind of separates yourself from a supplier to a solutions provider slash...
Yeah, so the risk is two ways. The risk is if we do come in with a product, technically we could be making the assumption that they need that product. However, we've got to kind of keep some things in our back pocket. But yeah, we don't want to go in there leading with.
But as a supplier, I have to bring in a product to the distributor so that they see what we are able to do. But as a distributor, they wouldn't want to do that.
Perfect. There you go. Love it. Yes.
I know that a lot of colleagues, they will go with no products just to create a relationship and to know. But then if I do that, I think to myself, then it's like, what can you offer? And then I have to send the products by email. But what at the end they are going to be buying? They are going to be buying the actual product. So I'm always dividing. Should I bring? I always bring because I feel that at the end, what he's going to be placing is an order for products. So I always bring what I think is cool for them. But I see people that they don't bring something, but for me it's okay with the relationship they kept. And after that, I have to go and search it and send my email with my PowerPoint. So I'm always debating, should I not? I personally bring samples.
Let me ask you something though, team. How many products do you have? Now,
what do you want?
So here's the key, right? What are we working on? Are we working on their strategy for whatever they're trying to do with your product, right? So is it fair to say that when you come in, you're trying to help them create some kind of messaging or awareness? Is that fair? Is it fair to say that what you're really good at, if they give you the chance, let me really understand what you're trying to achieve. What is that messaging that you're trying to create? And through that understanding, put me in a position where I can make some recommendations. Is that fair? I think that's what you do, right? That's what you do. No different than me. If I go in and I work with a company to talk about learning, they might say to me, Dave, do you got anything on objection handling? And my temptation would be what? Do I got anything on objection handling? Look at this. It's back of my t-shirt. It says objection handling. Of course I have objection handling. But if I go down that route, what's the risk?
That's all they call you for.
Well, it may not be the right solution for them. However, if I said, absolutely, that's an area that I can help you with, but before I get talking about what I do in objection handling, can I just invest some time with you to understand why you need objection handling? And all of a sudden you peel back the onion and then you realize you don't need objection handling. You need this, right? So that's what we do as a consultant. So I think, Logan, to your point, the risk is if I go in and I take the product and I kind of go, I've got this, I've assumed this is what you need. But if I go in with the mental state of, let me seek to understand first, let me understand what you're trying to achieve, that's a much different client experience. Team, that's being the consultant. That's being the consultant. Right? Very good. Now, I think just doing some research on their business, you know, what are they doing? What are their values? These things really resonate with people today. And that could be the core differentiator against you and anybody else that's in there selling them something. Just that you took the time to be well prepared. Okay, now here's the big one. We're gonna do an exercise around the jury. The two tables at the back are gonna become one team. So you're gonna join as a table of six, team of six. That team is gonna stay together right here unless you wanna make any trades. Like, I'd like to take these two people with a cash deal for these two people, right there, there you go.
Some future considerations.
Future considerations. This table and this table are gonna come together as a team of seven. If you can come here or you can move to here. This will be a team, team, team. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 teams, okay? Now, here's the quiz. Imagine for a moment that I have agreed to meet with you. You've called me up. And I said, yes, I would like to invest some time and learn more about you, what you do. Whether you're on the supply side or the distributor side, doesn't matter. I say to you, I'm willing to meet with you. And we determine that this meeting in length is going to be, well, let me ask you, how long do you need for a first discovery meeting? We determine it's going to be a 30-minute meeting. Okay? You have 30 minutes for me. During that 30 minutes, what are the fundamental steps that you go through to make sure that that is a productive 30 minutes? Woo. Fundamental steps. Now, just to see if we're on the right track, can anybody give me a fundamental step that you would go through in that 30 minutes? Okay, now, I heard listening. It is a fundamental step. Some say it happens during. It actually does, and it actually happens as a fundamental step. Can anybody give me another one? So I've prepared the questions, but during, I'm going to be doing what? Okay, there's two hints. You ready to go? Now, team, just for fun, I'm looking for 8 of them. Let's see what you come up with. You're going to join up? Team. Okay, team, I'm going to bring us back in about 1 minute. And we're gonna do the honesty quiz. And when I go through these steps, I want you to be very honest at your tables to see how close you were to being in the postal code on this exercise.
Can I have clarification?
Yes.
We are all salespeople.
Yes.
So honesty in salespeople is like an oxymoron.
Okay, there you go. That.
I just want to clarify.
Steve, we've already done the then and the now exercise, okay? Like, okay. All right, there you go. We're in the now, Matt. We're in the now.
Okay. All right.
Anybody ever heard of the trust quotient? The trust quotient. Yeah. There's a great book. If you want to read a really cool book, it's a nice read. It's called The Trusted Advisor. Anybody heard that book? Just Google it, Trusted Advisor. Trust. There is actually a formula for trust because we use that term a lot, right? The word trust. Trust is actually built upon the foundation, are you ready, of reliability. Are you reliable? That's part of trust. Credibility, what you say, right? Are you credible? Reliability, doing things that you said you would do on time. Credibility, right? You know, are you credible in what you're saying, right? Your knowledge, your expertise, all those kinds of things. You ready for this one? Intimacy. I know it's deep. But trust, you can measure trust with a customer. How do you know whether there is a foundation of intimacy in trust? What they share with you. How much information they share with you. Okay? Self-orientation for a salesperson is what you're doing is you're putting the client first. So the client is first, and you're going to determine what's important to them first before you determine of what's important to you, right? And that is an equation that builds out to trust. That's what people are looking for, right? So here's our quiz. There are 8 steps. Tomorrow we're going to dive all over the 8 steps. I'm going to get them in your DNA, right? They're going to get in the DNA. Look at Steve. He's already looking for them. I mean, he's finding them. He's looking for them, right? I know they're in there, man. No, you weren't, Steve. You got 2 right. No, only kidding you. Okay, here we go. Here we go. First step, you meet with me in my office. There is going to be some kind of?
Introduction.
A greeting, an introduction. Okay? Now, team, there's going to be a greeting or an introduction. Now, we're going to talk about this tomorrow. We're going to work on this. But there's a couple of fundamental things that salespeople do in their greeting. And we do a greeting and an introduction, but really what are we trying to do early with somebody that we are getting to know for the first time? We're trying to build what?
Rapport.
Now there's 2 ways of building rapport. A lot of salespeople build rapport in their greeting on what we call small talk. What do you think I mean by that? Small talk. Yeah, it's snowing out, you know. Hey, you know, you're in the office. That moose on the wall, do you like to hunt? No, came with the office. I really don't like to hunt. So sometimes what we do is we try and create rapport through what I call small talk. Now, I'm not saying I don't want you to do that with your clients, but what's the risk sometimes doing that with somebody that we're meeting with for the first time in their business? How?
Well, like you said, it's moose. post and he said, I just want to keep you, you're a vegetarian.
Yeah. Right. There you go. So in our preparation, what I like to do in my greeting is think about what could I connect with people on, not on the small talk, but what I call business rapport. So what could I leverage about what I know in their business? Maybe something that they're doing in the community, but something that allows me to connect with them, build that rapport, start to get it on the journey of trust, but it makes it easier for me to transition into why we're here today. Does that make sense? So let me give you an example. Imagine that I'm meeting with somebody and they just recently won an award. And I said, you know, I meet Steve. Steve says, Dave, welcome to my office. And I walk into his office and say, Steve, by the way, I want to congratulate you. That was really impressive to see that you've won again in your industry this award. What were some of the things that you did this year to get, right? That's, I'm building the rapport. See what I'm doing? It's a little bit different. It's a safe commonality. Now, technically what happens? How many of you have customers that have become friends of yours? Hands up. Yeah, I have clients of mine that I've known for years. And how do we become friends? What happens? Over time, what happens though, David? We get to know each other and what happens?
Trust and rapport.
Yeah, trust and rapport. Is it fair to say we start to find that we have things in common? We have common things in our lives and we become friends. On a first meeting, we have nothing in common quite yet. And quite frankly, what happens is rapport is a journey. It happens over time through learning about people. So what I like to do is I like to use the smaller talk at the back end of the meeting, the opposite. It's when we've built the trust, I've learned about the business, people are feeling good, and they might say, hey, by the way, you know, and all of a sudden you're in that conversation. But at the beginning, that greeting, I like to build rapport based on the business foundation. What do I know about their business? Something that's exciting for them. That's my connector. Make sense? That is a step. Now, I transition off the greeting, and at some point, I need to get control of what?
The conversation.
Of why we're here today, Roz, the conversation. So, I need to establish what with the customer? The purpose of the meeting, which is going to be, Ken, leveraged off of the phone call. So, I'm responsible to set the purpose of the meeting. And I need to say to the customer, right, I would say, Ken, as I mentioned to you on the phone, the purpose of our meeting today is for me to learn more about your business, specifically your acquisition strategy, and to share with you some insight on what we're doing to work with organizations like yours to help you meet those goals. How's that? That is the purpose of the meeting. That's why we're here today. Whatever that purpose is, I need to lay that out. Why is it important to lay that purpose out very early? I want to be on the same page. Is it fair to say they might be going, what are you doing here? I can't remember. That is the purpose. Now, the purpose needs to have some substance to it. I'm trying to drive it into what I know about their business. I'm trying to elevate the value that I can bring by not talking about the product, but maybe sharing with them, you know, sharing what we're doing to help organizations like yours with their branding experience or their customer acquisition experience. Whatever that is, I want it to resonate with them. Now, there's step one, two, the greeting, building business rapport, the purpose for the meeting, setting the context for where we're going in this meeting. Okay, step number three. What do you think? Okay, knew it was gonna happen. Thank you, Logan. That is a step. However, it is step number four. Now, let me throw this by you. What do I need to do just before I start asking questions? Yes? Okay, now, I need to listen, but I'm gonna be listening while I'm asking questions. What's the risk if I just start asking questions? Okay. Yep. Now, how many of you ask permission to ask questions? Now, I'm going to give you a couple. I call this step number three, gaining the customer's commitment to participate. Does that make sense? Three things I've got to do here. Three things. If I did it with you today. What did I need to tell you today to cause you to participate? You have participated with me today, team. You're actually loving it because you're going, we only got 20 more minutes of this guy. But at least he laid out what? The agenda. So here's what it looks like. Gaining customer commitment, I got to do a couple of things. One, how much time has this customer given us? Is it important for me to reconfirm that we still have our 30 minutes? Why? Respect for their time, Logan. Could something have changed since I met with them? Have you ever been in a meeting and you're in the meeting and you got brilliance going and all of a sudden the customer does this to you? Right? They look at the watch. What do you do when a customer looks at the watch? I gotta tell you, the products will come flying. You only got 5 minutes? Look out, man. Hang on for dear life because you're going to get flooded right now with some stuff. Here's what I want to do to gain commitment to participate. One, confirm the time. Two, permission to ask questions. Three, permission to capture information. You ready? Here's what it might sound like. Hey, Logan, just before we get started, I just want to confirm that we still have our half an hour together today. What do you have?
10 minutes.
Okay, now I'm in a good, am I in a good spot? I'm in a good spot. Why am I in a good spot? I know I have 10 minutes. Don't worry about it. I'm not gonna get kicked out after five because he's just giving me 10. I can make a lot happen in 10. Don't worry about that. But I've respected his time right now. Now, if I didn't ask him that, right? Now, let's say I get nice Logan. Logan actually did this at the beginning. You weren't watching, I was watching him, but he was kind of going like this. So he was giving me the buying signal. Then he said, forget that guy, man. I'm going to give him a hard time here. So you only got 10. So I ask. Now, 9 times out of 10, I think when you ask, what do you think people are going to say to you? Yeah. So here's how you ask. You ready? Hey, Logan, I just want to confirm before we get started, we still have 30 minutes together.
Actually, maybe you got 45.
There you go, man. It's even better. So the reality is when you ask, here's what people are thinking. Hey, thank you for appreciating my time. That was respectful. And they literally say to me, they go, absolutely. 30 minutes is great, Dave. Now they know we have 30 minutes. Is that good? Now, what do I have by them knowing now that they have 30 minutes? What have I just created? That's it. That's all I'm trying to do. Now I've got them focused. I've removed them from everything else subconsciously because they are now removed from how long are we going to be here? No different team than when I kicked off this workshop. That's all I wanted to do. I wanted to get you learning ready by simply saying to you, here's where the breaks is, here's where lunch is, here's when we're getting out of here. And the minute I did that, standing in front of you, you would not believe the body language and how it changed. You, as a facilitator, just watching you, it was almost like this, okay, this is okay so far. It's not bad. Okay? We got an agenda. We're getting a break. We're going to eat. We're getting out of here for, I'm good. That's it. That's all that happened, right? That's all that happened. Now, why ask permission to ask questions before asking questions? Respect. People are going to share information with you. Now, even if I ask you an open-ended question, a poll question, is it fair to say that you could give me a one-word answer? Yes. Here's a study for you. Med school. They took a group of patients, they put them in a room, took another group of patients, put them in a room. They had a couple of doctors. First doctors that went in to interview patients one-on-one walked in there and just started asking the patients about their health. Just started asking them questions. What do you think happened to those patients? What do you think? How do you think they answered? How do you think they felt? David?
One-word
answers. Why? They were nervous about what?
Well, they didn't trust where the doctor was.
That's it. So they didn't share information. They were one-word answers, and they were scared. They were scared that if they shared information, the doctor was going to find something wrong with them, and they just said, yeah, that's good. I'm good. I'm good. Now, second set of doctors sitting with the patients sounded like this. David, just before we get started, I'm going to ask you some questions today. I'm going to ask you some questions about your health. The more information you share with me today, it's going to put me in a position to do what I do best, make some recommendations on how I can really help you. And when they did that, the patient's level of sharing went through the roof. Because A, they knew why the doc was asking. B, they were now feeling comfort in the more information they shared them, that would help them opposed to holding information back. Make sense? There it is. That's number two. Now three, how many of you take notes in meetings? Very good. Look at some of you are going like this. We're not supposed to be taking notes. Is that in the then and the now? What's going on? No, no, that's good. Taking notes is good. What does taking notes demonstrate? That you are actively engaged. That's how you're making me feel, team, as a facilitator. I feel good. Because you're capturing stuff. You're writing stuff down.
I was loving the prospect.
Okay, that's even better. Now, if I just start taking notes in a meeting without asking permission to take notes, what's the risk? It does. So I got to let them know why. So I'm going to ask you some questions, and then I'm going to actually say to them, you know, along the way, I'm going to, if you don't mind, I'd like to take some notes. It's important for me to capture everything that's important to you today. What do you think? People say to me, absolutely, Dave, take notes. Now, if I'm in the meeting and all of a sudden, Logan says, you know what our real problem is around here, man? It's marketing. That David in marketing's dropping the ball. I'm not going, so let me get that right. David in marketing's dropping the ball. That's maybe where I'm just gently putting my pen down, putting it down, and I'm no longer taking notes. See, notes is an art. Notes is the ability to capture the information we need, but it's also the ability to build rapport. So there we go. Step one, two, three. One, building business rapport, the greeting. Two, establishing the meeting purpose. Why are we here today? Three, gaining customer commitment to participate. Confirming time, permission to ask questions, permission to take notes. What do you think, team? Do you do those three steps consistently? And that's why we're here, because the reality is that is a conscious behavior, being consciously aware of that behavior. And I know those three steps sound simple, but they are a differentiator. They are incredibly powerful. Now, step number four, ask questions. We call that effective discovery, or the consultative investigation, or asking questions. And we're going to talk about the strategy of asking great questions. And we're going to look at this strategy tomorrow. It's understanding the current situation of the business, their desired future state, who else is involved, and what their expectations are of us. And we're going to look at being effective at asking questions. Step number four. Now, ask all kinds of questions. And at some point, I got to demonstrate what? Because I've been taking notes, so I got to demonstrate that I have been listening. How do I demonstrate that I'm listening? Yes, and I'm writing things down. And at some point, I can physically demonstrate, David, that I'm listening by doing what?
Basically, summarizing what, this is what I thought I heard you say, and use some of the same language that they use.
How good is that? Yes. So I'm going to periodically summarize back, and I'm going to say, so let me make sure I got this right. Here's a couple of teeth. Is that anything else I need? Yeah, that's it. You got it. Beautiful. So I am listening. And one of the things that we're going to talk about is sometimes we summarize our understanding and then we prioritize the needs of the client. I call that summarize and prioritize. So sometimes clients will serve up a lot of things to us and I summarize it back. What's prioritize?
Putting it in order.
Love it, Roz. And who does that? The client, by me doing what?
Listening to what they can tell.
So I summarize back, and then I'm going to ask them a question. Hey, Ken, did I get it right? Yeah. Now, out of those five things that we talked about today, if you were going to rank them in importance to you and your business, walk me through the priorities. What do you think? We got to do this first, man. This, this, and this. Why get the customer to prioritize their needs?
Sure.
Well, sometimes a customer has a need, but it's not a priority need. And what we want to do is we want to align our solution against their priority needs. That's it. Beautiful. Step number six is, I got all the needs. I've prioritized them. Come on, team, this is the most exciting spot. I get to recommend, talk about some solutions, make some recommendations on how I can help you. How good is that? Now, when I recommend a solution and I present some ideas on how I can help you, you've got to be able to see what? The value. Love it. You've got to be able to see the value. So for me to demonstrate that value, step number seven is, how do I quantify the benefits of that solution? But to do that, I've got to be able to tie it back to what? Their needs. There it is. That's what we call step number seven. Kind of quantify the benefits so they can see the impact of that on their needs. And then finally, step number eight is?
Say goodbye.
Not quite goodbye yet. Yeah, now it's, yes?
Commitment to the next step.
How good is that? It's a commitment to a next step. Now, a next step could be a close. Right now, PO, done. A next step, however, could be another meeting. It might be meeting somebody else in the organization. It might be coming back to make a presentation, a recommendation. Could be a number of things. Is that fair? But I need to secure some kind of go-forward commitment. Team, those are our eight steps. Tomorrow, we're going to have an opportunity to burn them into your DNA. We're going to have some fun. We're actually going to do a skill drill around the eight steps. What do you think of the eight steps? And they are in there. They are in there. Just didn't find, and they are in order. You just didn't find them in time. All right, nice job. Now, we're going to put a bow around this, team. We covered a lot of ground in day one. Couple things I'd like you to do. I'd just like you to go to page 21 and just kind of take a look at some of the things that you did today. I'd like you to reflect. So I got you to capture notes in box 1, 2, and 3. Give you a minute just to capture some ideas around what resonated with you on box number 4, the changing role of the salesperson. One or two things that really grabbed your attention. And then I'll just kind of set up a little bit of what we're going to do tomorrow. And then I'm going to give you the rest of the day off. How's that? Man. Changing role of the sales professional team. Did anything resonate with you around that piece?
Be prepared, preparation.
Absolutely. And I think the big one is really making sure we think about some of the questions we're going to ask, our knowledge of that person's industry and their business. As much as we're preparing to bring things, we need to really take the time to understand what's going on in their business and their industry. Yeah. Anybody else?
I like the term local.
Yeah, local, yes.
That helps, like understanding that and how it affects each of us in our different roles. I think that's important.
Cool, yeah. All right. So team, covered a lot of ground today, right? Covered a lot of ground. If you think about the journey we were on, anybody remember the three levels of value, by the way? Just out of curiosity. Supply, solution, and strategic. Very nice. How good is that? Could anybody walk me through the five steps within the connectivity script? We got the introduction.
The development of
demonstration of preparation.
Value prop.
The value prop.
Present the opportunity.
Present the opportunity using words like?
And commitment to action.
Commitment to action. How good is that? Surrounded by the pause. There we go. Okay.
Surround the pause.
Pretty good. Can anybody give me the fifth step of the eight steps? I got 4, I got 6, and I got 8. And I asked for the fifth. No, I'm kidding you. There it is. Fifth is summarize and prioritize. There you go. Very nice. Good day today?
Yes.
All right. Team, I loved your energy to learn. So tomorrow, we are on at 9 o'clock. My only ask is think about a customer that you might just want to poke your eyes on their website, do a little bit of just touch point research. We're on in this room at, no, we're in a different room tomorrow. Roz, we are in a different room. Is that correct? Yes. Somebody said we were in a different room tomorrow.
We have a salon agency.
We're still here.
Yeah.
Okay, we're still here tomorrow. I thought we were in a different room. Okay, we're here. Same room. 9 o'clock start, and tomorrow we go until 2 o'clock. All right. Tomorrow's skill drill day. Have a good night. Remember, it is a school night tonight. I'll see you in the morning.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay.